Thank you very much. It is an honor to be here. Before I start, I would like to just share a little story with Hank Meyer. 32 years ago, really the first advertising that we ever did was when I was in that little green truck. I snuck over to Meyer Thrifty Acres in Okemos, and they had a board on the wall that you could put your business card on. And I slunk in there with a picture of the truck and rip-off numbers, and then I snuck out. And now I'm sharing a stage with the guy, and it's quite amazing, so thank you. If you have any more marketing tips, Hank and Mark, I'm all ears up here. To get started, I wish I could say that the Two Men in a Truck story read like a fairy tale, started by the perfect family mirrored in this video that you just saw. Unfortunately, that would be a self-promoting commercial, which I'm not above that, by the way. But it also wouldn't be the truth. I have learned the hard way. All businesses and individual careers, for that matter, go through a life cycle. They are born, and if they continue to learn, evolve, and change with the times, they live a long and healthy life. If not, they simply die. And by God's grace, Two Men in a Truck was fortunate enough to survive the trappings of early success and learn a valuable lesson that we pull from today. You are either growing your business or you're dying, and it's that simple. Two Men in a Truck started actually with two boys in the truck in 1980. The business was incorporated in 1985, and we started franchising in 89. Like many businesses, we learned our trade on the fly in moving and franchising. By 2008, we were doing $185 million in moving with 173 franchises. And it was about this time we could start feeling the business taper off. Two Men in the Truck felt the recession early. We drew the quick conclusion that less people with jobs and money and fewer banks issuing mortgages equaled fewer customers. The conclusion was only half true, however. There were indeed less customers, but we found out later that we were failing and losing our customers before our trucks even hit their driveway. This was actually outpacing the recession for Two Men in a Truck. Before the housing bubble popped, we were too busy actually moving people to look at the condition of our business. In other words, we were too busy cutting trees to sharpen the saw. When the recession hit in 2009, we opened up a smoking hood to see the damage. And this is what we found. And if you could, I hate that picture. But I'm going to share it with you anyway. And I'm going to share some other things with you, too, that might shock you. First thing we found out was our customers changed. Customers wanted to communicate using the web. Our website was old and clunky, and our visitor bounce rate was 82%. Those were the potential customers that quit our message. Most franchises were not checking their emails. We found that tens of thousands of emails went unanswered in our system. Franchisees continued pouring marketing dollars into the yellow page advertising, and our customers were using less and less of that. Our customer service reps became order takers on the phone. We lost the ability to sell services during the housing boom. Modern business demands outpaced the skill sets of the people at our corporate office in every department, in IT, finance, marketing, even operations. We were not capable of change or measuring change. Organizational charts at our corporate office lacked clarity. We found some of our employees were doing the work of four people. We found out we had other employees that couldn't find their way out of a broom closet. Job descriptions were vague at best. Many of us came from the operational side of the business. We were a jack of all trades, masters of none. We were skilled at putting out fires in the business, but we were terrible at avoiding them. Because of these dysfunctional layers, we lacked accountability across the board. As the business became more complicated, so did the contracts with our vendors. In several cases, we were taken advantage of, and we paid a hefty price for that. During this time, Two Men in a Truck had a sizable nest egg invested that our banker and controller at the time called a money market fund, which turned out to be mortgage-backed securities. More on that later. On the franchise side, franchisees did not wait for our corporate office. They worked on their own websites and their own SEO. On the other side, we had franchises that turned their back on anything that had to do with the internet. This really diluted our brand. Among these things, these are some of the things that I faced when I became president in 2006. So if you look at all the things that I just listed there, a lot of it didn't have to do with the recession. So where do you start when you deal with all these issues? I started in prayer, and I asked Christ, how do we go about fixing your moving business? While praying, I still remembered my ace in the hole, though, my money market account that I had. It would be enough to start the building blocks of a comeback. Later in that same afternoon, I got a call from my banker. He said the money market account uses an auction to buy and sell shares. This is how you get your money out. This auction has collapsed, and it might take months to get your money back out, if ever. Back to the office for more prayer. I found our God is a heck of a businessman and also has a unique way of getting all of your attention. Well, he definitely got mine, because now we had no working capital. We were at a pivotal point in the business, a true live and die moment. But I found decisions have more clarity in moments like this. This is how we got back on track, saved the company, and started 46 months of continuous growth that continue to this day. Most of those months were in the grip of a recession. That a baby. That's a picture I like to see. All right. First of all, it starts out with accountability. It starts with us as CEOs and presidents and high-ranking executives. Everything wrong in the delivery side of that business is my fault, period. We are either not training for it, not asking for it, or not keeping people accountable. There's no blame game. I started with the biggest pain point, our IT. I hired Plant Moran to do a full assessment of our processes, people, equipment, and software. I told him to keep it simple. Give me a letter grade for each one of these in a detailed summary in English so I can make some decisions. They came back 3 months later and they made it really simple. They gave me Fs on everything. They did say we had nice people, but they did not have the skill sets to support our systems. As Plant was leaving the office, one of the guys leaned over and said, by the way, Brig, you have software valued at about $50,000 sitting on the floor of your IT room in an unopened box, and it's been there about 3 months. Just thought you might want to know that. I told him I would simply make some changes and bring in new people. They said it's not that easy. No one knows how your system works. It's a bowl of spaghetti. So you have to hire new people and have them work right next to the people that you're going to let go. And you know what? Compared to failure, that's an easy decision to make, but it was pretty hard to do. But that's what we did. I also hired a new CFO. I asked him to first fire the bank and take a good long look at our accounting firm. And before he left my office, he said, give me that mortgage-backed securities file. I'm going to get our money back. Which he did. And Jeff, you're out there somewhere, but thanks, brother. We then revamped our marketing and our web presence. We hired an HR executive and started a legitimate HR department. We revamped our organizational charts. We went from 78 employees down to 52 ass kickers. Excuse my French. We severanced every single person out that we let go. We severanced over $250,000 when we were cash strapped. I know some of you and some of the businesses in here will spend that much on jet fuel in about a month, but that's about all that we had. We helped many of them find new jobs, and we rewrote all of the existing job qualifications. I now had 4 highly skilled executives leading the departments that could negotiate vendor agreements. Over time, we were able to renegotiate or break one-sided agreements or fire vendors who took advantage of our company. It saved us hundreds of thousands of dollars in 1 year, and we used a lot of that money to help build the business. We put new training for frontline employees together. We hired a company, and they helped us train our frontline staff, and we wanted to help them become sales makers instead of order takers. It was a huge, huge move for our company. We met with our top franchisees and asked them how we could better partner with them to put more trucks and driveways. We also had re-engagement, or what we called internally as come-to-Jesus meetings with franchisees who were detached from their businesses or who were unwilling to make changes. We turned over 20% of our franchises in 3 years. We required accountability in the franchise side of the business by harnessing our vast data and posting vast amounts of performance metrics on the extranet for everybody to see. We put standard accounting and IT practices in place. We increased our IT fee from $175 a month to a little over $1,200 a month in the height of the recession. Most franchisees were not happy, but they understood why. Some franchisees tried to start an association. Some still hate me to this day. That's all right. Our IT department grew from 6 people to 25 in 5 years and have now written our own operating software in-house, dramatically helping our franchisees manage more resources to continue to increase market share. I have a quote that hangs over my desk. A ship in port is safe, but that's not what ships were built for. 5 years ago, we sailed 2 men in a truck out of port and into the deep blue waters of business. That's where the adventure is, and that's where businesses thrive. We did not have the luxury of waiting for the recession storm to pass. I'm glad we faced it when we did. In that storm, we became better business people, and there was lots of market share to be had at times when others stayed in port. A couple of things that I learned along the way. It sounds crazy, but after all those years, most of it was a lot of fun. And also never to think your business can only grow in an up economy. I am confident all businesses can improve and increase business regardless of the economy. When the economy is stormy, don't sit inside by a fire. Throw on your Carhartt and your boots and get out into it. Don't be afraid to make changes at the executive level. You owe it to your customers, your brand, your employees, and your family to have the highest energy, positive, and intelligent minds wearing out your office carpet, asking the challenging questions, and offering up new ideas. And I'd also add, executives, don't waste your time and talents on a company that's content with the status quo. It could be a career-ending mistake. Surround yourself with bona fide, highly skilled, self-motivated ass-kickers and listen to them. Make them the leading characters in the adventure. My leading cast of characters are all from Michigan, and all of them have college degrees in Michigan. At the end of the year, I check these metrics. Did everybody win? Customers. Did customer satisfaction increase even though we've had crazy growth with the company? Franchisees, did they put more trucks in driveways and did they become more profitable than what they were last year? Our corporate office, are we financially stable, building the careers of our employees and finding ways to better support our frontline staff? In our communities, did we give more back to the communities that we serve than we did last year? And our vendor partners should be profitable and growing alongside us and should be proud to help us build our brand. In conclusion, always pray for discernment when it comes to making business decisions. Give thanks for the blessings that are showered on us daily and pray that we always have a hunger to learn and get better. Thank you. May God bless you all.